morning, and thanks, Ish, for that nice intro and context setting. Very happy to be here. I think originally the plan was to speak yesterday, but I couldn't do that for an interesting meeting that happened in the afternoon in the finance ministry, where we do our annual exercise of securing our funds so we can keep investing in the technology. And one of the questions that was posed to us is, you know, fine, you know, you guys are going to make all these investments, but what kind of technology are you investing? Are you investing in decisions that were made a decade back? Or are you going to be investing in technology for tomorrow? And I think that was it was very interesting that those questions were coming from the ministry that funds us. And so I think it makes this discussion very timely and pertinent, because you know, any future investments that we make, should they be based on where technology was last decade, or should it be where technology will be the next decade? So thanks again for having me, and you know, it's good to see that we have two standards bodies from, you know, across the Indo-Pacific coming together. That's a strategic convergence of sorts. And you know, very interesting that, you know, TSI and ATSE have come together to host this event. And at a time when we have the Prime Minister Modi in Singapore doing a similar Indo-Pacific, you know, confluence of thoughts with, you know, the Vice President. Just on my way, I saw a tweet from the Prime Minister looking forward to meeting the American Vice President later today. So this Indo-Pacific thinking, which you know, this should probably extend to technology as well, and I think that's where the future opportunity lies. And one of the thoughts that comes to my mind when I think of convergence, you know, the history of the last three decades, how technology has evolved, right? You know, the first sort of convergence that I saw, at least in my career, was how traditional telephony and networking just merged, right? You had this world of SS7, traditional telephony, and then you have the IP world, TCP/IP, and so on, and then both of them just blurred, and with voice over IP, it no longer matters what is the underlying technology. Then as a consumer, I saw the line blurring between traditional cable TV and internet, right? Because you had one box for getting your TV services, you had another box for your internet, and then that just became a single box in a matter of years. And then you had fiber to home, which converged all three. Because you had one fiber box, which you got your telephone line, you got your internet. Right. So convergence has sort of, you know, created this new user experience where today it no longer matters where, you know, what is the underlying medium, what is the underlying technology. As long as I can get my content, I can get my services. And it's already happening with the iPhone, the iPad, the Amazon Alexa at home. You know, whatever is the consumer interface of your choice. And so in that sense, the consumer is way ahead of us. So when we talk of broadband broadcast convergence, I think we are playing catch up. We are probably a few years behind, while the consumer is way ahead of us. and in a conversation I was observing a couple of days back, you know, how when I was growing up, you go to the barber shop, they play music from a traditional radio. And this weekend when I went to get a shave, I see he's playing songs out of YouTube, streamed on, you know, 4G, and hardly bothered about, you know, how the content is coming, right? So it's a dramatic change in the way content is being consumed by the masses. So in that sense, when we think of convergence, we now need to really think about what is the next vista in terms of consumer applications. Where is the consumer going in terms of the expectations they have of, you know, the future user experience and the kind of apps that they want to use? So it really does not matter if you're, you know, on DVB T2 or ATSC or 4G LTE or 5G. I don't think the consumer really cares about this alphabet soup, and very unlikely that tomorrow's consumers are even going to notice what that underlying technology is. because they really want to make their choices based on the content and the user experience. And this is not some faraway future, man. This is a present reality that we are facing. So that I think makes it all the more important that when we think of what broadcast broadband convergence should mean, I think the focus has to be on the use cases of the future. And I think we in India are in a very unique situation, unlike the more advanced markets in the West, especially when it comes to broadcasting. To take one example, 3 decades back in telephony, we made one big leap. Right? India was, in those days, you had very little penetration of telephones. You had to go to a public call, PCO, to make a long distance call. And it would be very expensive during the day. I remember going after 10 p.m. in the night to make a call home, if you're away, right? And that was what India was 3 decades back. And then in a matter of years, it just dramatically changed with mobile telephony. We just skipped the intermediate steps and we just went mobile. And then you had universal access of mobility, across the all segments of the country. And which has now, I think, trickled down even further with platforms like Jio and so on. Right. So that is one leapfrog that happened on the telecom side. In terrestrial broadcasting, I think we are in a similar situation. Right? While most of the markets made the linear transition from analog to digital, we are very slow. We've been very slow. We still have a large analog terrestrial infrastructure. We've enabled digital in barely 19 cities. And even there is hardly any digital activity as of now. So in that sense, is the moment right for us also to make a similar leap from where we skip that intermediate step of analog to digital to whatever to this direct to mobile future that been brainstorming about the last 2 days. So what if we think of a roadmap that directly gets us to that future where we don't make these intermediate investments. And so to give you a sense of where we are today, right? Probably about 18 months back, we had a few thousand analog terrestrial transmitters across the country. And in the last 1 year, I think we embarked on a very ambitious task of rationalizing our analog terrestrial operations. We started with a few 200 odd low power transmitters which had to be decommissioned. Now that has gone even further. Now I think the number is somewhere at 600, which includes LPTs, VLPTs, and the goal is to take this even further and even look at some of the high power transmitters as well, if there's a need to continue with it. But then what do we do on the digital side, right? Because at this point we have 23 DTT transmitters in 19 cities. We have another 44 that are waiting to be digitized. We probably have a few hundred low power transmitters which are digital ready. So do we take the same linear evolution or do we jump to the future? So hence my concern is less a debate about standards, whether it is DVB-T2 or ATSC 3.0. I think there is little value to us in the linear evolution of replacing an existing analog transmitter with a new digital transmitter, because the consumer has moved far ahead of us in how he or she consumes content. So the challenge really is, can we create a market, a new market, based on convergence? Where that drives our future technology investments, which takes us to this direct to mobile future. And what is that roadmap? I think that is really the question that we need to address. What new market can we create with this convergence? What new user experience can we create with this convergence? That defines how consumers will exchange with services, how will unmet needs be serviced? And more importantly, what is that killer app? Today, maybe last decade, the killer app was the web browser, and before that it was email, and now it's probably WhatsApp, right? So when we talk about broadcast broadband convergence, what is that killer app that will emerge from this landscape and that will fundamentally disrupt how things are done? Because the reality today is that both traditional telecom and traditional broadcasting are losing out to the internet-based platforms. And I think this is a daily reality. In fact, on my, and even the internet platforms are being forced to rethink their strategy. A few months back, I remember reading that, you know, Netflix is not going to change its subscription-based model. And just this morning, I see a tweet that Netflix is looking at a mobile-only subscription model which will be priced lower than, you know, the traditional. So even they are being forced to relook at their business models. So what disruption that should emerge from this convergence has to get ahead of them. So it won't be merely enough to, you know, demonstrate a new chip, you know, which is capable of multiple standards, but what is that killer app that is going to emerge on that infrastructure that will take advantage of that chip and fundamentally change how, you know, consumers interact with this technology. So it is fine to, you know, to look at aspects like, can we be more spectrum efficient, can we offload traffic from, you know, broadband to the broadcast spectrum and so on. But I think the real question is, what are those futuristic consumer scenarios which can potentially change how things are done, which can fundamentally, you know, disrupt the landscape as it exists today? So I just did some forward thinking. Again, these are, you know, some ideas. Maybe what eventually emerges is going to be dramatically different. So one thought, you know, in the age of Amazon Alexa and Amazon Prime, should there really be a distinction between TV and radio? Does it matter anymore, right? Because I can ask Alexa to either play NPR or play All India Radio or just give me the news, and it just sources news from, you know, a bunch of sources, which are both traditional TV, traditional radio, and internet, right? So that line is practically blurred. So should we even look at TV and radio as two separate media anymore? Today, my smartphone is capable of receiving all kinds of broadcast signals. I mean, if this chip that you're talking about can do that, with, you know, across standards, then the underlying alphabet soup of technologies just does not matter, right? Because the app is what will determine, you know, what the consumer is going to consume, and it wouldn't matter if the content originated from a TV station, a radio channel, or on the internet. So it won't really matter, you know, as long as I get the news that I care about, you know, it doesn't matter where it's coming from. Similarly, in the age of, you know, Netflix and YouTube, is the TV remote relevant to me? Why should I be forced to browse what content is airing across broadcast channels, be it satellite or cable, in a very linear fashion using a relic called the TV remote, right? Why can't Alexa tell me that, you know, based on what my viewing history is, what my preferences are, that at this point in time you should be watching this on HBO or this on Star Bharat or that on Zee and Mool and so on. Right? So why should the television viewing experience still be trapped in that remote? I mean, that can dramatically change. So with more personalization, more recommendations, internet-like, you know, the way you experience broadcasting itself would be dramatic. And I think this is not too far off. This is going to happen very soon. Then something more radical. Today we have a big debate on sports, live sports, especially in India, where we have a whole bunch of sporting events which are available only on pay TV. And then we have a law that requires certain live sporting events of national importance to be shared with the public broadcaster, so they are available free to air. Now, this law has been in force for about a decade or so, and about a year back, the Supreme Court said that you know, it is fine to declare certain live sporting events of, you know, being of national importance, but you should restrict their availability only to your platforms of the public broadcaster, be it free-to-air terrestrial TV or free-to-air DTH, not the private platforms. So since that Supreme Court verdict came, the private platforms would block our sports channel, DD Sports, whenever there's a live sporting event of national importance. And I'm just amazed at the barrage of social media comments I get every time this happens. That why is Airtel blocking DD Sports? Why is Tata Sky blocked? And every time you go to explain to them, you know, there is a Supreme Court verdict. You can only watch it on terrestrial TV or on free dish. You can't watch it on, you know, the private platforms. And it's been 12 months, right? And we've had big cricket, you know, events. We had, you know, England series. We had New Zealand. We've had IPL. But the same, you know, story that the consumer is not ready to subscribe to the whatever is the pay model for watching live sports, and they want flexibility in, the, in, you know, how they consume live sports. So what if tomorrow there's a business model that says that I want to pay to watch only the last 5 overs of the T20 match of an IPL game? Because I don't care about what happens in the rest of the match. I'll probably watch it on YouTube as highlights or on Hotstar. I'll just, you know, subscribe to the highlights package. But the live action, I just want those last 5 to 10 overs, right? Can I pay for that? Today, you don't have a business model that allows you that. You either have a fixed subscription model or you have a free ad-driven model. But you don't really have pay-as-you-go models where you can consume content flexibly by, you know, in smaller quantities, you know, in bite-sized quantities. And but interestingly, we have the payment infrastructure for that. Couple of years back, you know, India took this leap forward towards cashless payments. So now you have something called the Bheem UPI app. In fact, the PM spoke about it yesterday in a speech in Singapore on FinTech. And you have Aadhaar-enabled payments. So today you have the ability to pay small amounts very seamlessly using digital technology. So why can't content be merchandised and sold in a similar manner, right? And will that fundamentally change broadcasting, where you don't have to pay a large monthly subscription, you don't have to go completely free, but you can do pay as you go based on what content matters to you when it matters to you, right? So these are some of the futuristic scenarios that came to my mind when I was thinking of what is the future that this convergence can create. And I'm probably, you know, merely scratching the surface here on what this direct to mobile future can be. I think ultimately the killer apps will come from the marketplace of ideas, and our job is to create that environment, because we will not be the ones who innovate, but we will be the ones who create the platform, create the ecosystem, and give the space for people to innovate. And the innovative ideas will then come from, you know, the startups, the you know, app developers, and probably even the consumer. So the investment that we've made in DTT as of today, for example, in the 19 cities, is available for this innovation. And the question is, how can we create value out of it? So I'm happy to say that there is some interest that has come from the education sector. Because the broader consumer market, just because of the lack of availability of receiver sets, has not really taken to digital terrestrial TV. But if you look at perhaps specific use cases where the end user group is tightly controlled, like in education, maybe skills training, where you control the end user device, and so you're not dependent on large mass offtake of new devices by consumers. Perhaps that is where we will begin, and that will give us the business case for how you know, DTT can deliver value. Another area is public services like emergency alerts, disaster management. You know, the existing terrestrial infrastructure could be used for that, especially when we know that the cellular infrastructure may not scale up, you know, when disaster strikes. Similarly, on radio services, today there is a high entry barrier. If you want to operate radio services, you have to get a license, you have to invest in transmitters, you have to lease out space from us on the towers and so on. But what if the digital DTT infrastructure that I've put gives you a very low entry point for offering radio services? And will that lead to a whole new range of interactive radio services which are low cost? So that's another possibility. So what I would really like from the technology ecosystem is to tell us how the public infrastructure can be creatively leveraged to realize this convergence. Because then that will give us a way forward. That will tell us, you know, what roadmap our future investments can be. So when we look at the next 44 cities to be digitized, we'll know how to go about that. When we look at these few hundred digital ready transmitters, maybe there's a low cost option, you know, approach to get them digitized, which gets us to our DTM future much faster. So these are the steps that, you know, potentially we can take to embark on this converged journey towards a direct mobile future. So these are some of the thoughts that I have to share this morning. Thank you again for this opportunity, and I compliment both TSDSI and DTSC for, you know, bringing all this together to have this brainstorming. You know, happy to take any questions.
Of licensing process. I know in the United States, we might perhaps take a position from your reference that you've got, you know, a couple hundred transmission facilities that could be digitalized but have not been. We perhaps would approach the FCC and we would ask either for an experimental license, or we would ask for an STA to extend operations in a different arena. And what are the steps and opportunities in India? I can think of literally dozens of vendors who would be open to the opportunity to take a transmission facility, to convert it to DTM, to explore the possibilities and generate the ecosystem around that, to develop an understanding of the opportunity. How would any entity act on that kind of a process of gaining access on an experimental or temporary authority to do that?
It's an interesting question, because I think it'll probably involve multiple entities. I don't think we've solved the ease of experimentation that well yet. But one of our facilities where, you know, we are decommissioning analog would be a potential site to do an experiment of that nature. But regulatorily, you know, how to get the necessary permission, I mean, that's something we could work. If there are ideas on the table, that's something we could figure out together. I will give it to you.
Yesterday during the discussion, the point that came up was that maybe unlike other countries, especially USA, in India we have only one broadcaster, which is Prasar Bharati. Is that an enabler?
We have one terrestrial broadcaster.
Terrestrial broadcaster.
We have many satellite broadcasters.
Okay. So is that something, is this an area that should be opened up, liberalized? Is this helping us, or, you know?
No, I think absolutely, because TRAI has already said that the sector should be opened up to the private players, and they've made their recommendations. MIB referred those recommendations to us. We endorsed it and we replied to MIB saying that yes, we support that as well. In fact, even yesterday's conversation, I was very pleasantly surprised. The finance ministry was asking us, why haven't you explored private-public models for doing this? So we are open to that. So MIB, I think, now has set up a committee to examine how private sector can participate in the terrestrial TV market. So that committee will then implement the recommendations. Great, thank you.